Hallelujah. Well, I've got a degree in personnel management from USL. When I was in school, I like to study human history. I don't get a lot of chance to do that as much as I used to because I enjoy studying the Word, but I like to go back and study culture and study the civilizations and study different things from the past, and I enjoy doing that. And one of the things that we learn is that early civilizations all built their cities. It seems like the earliest civilizations were found around the Tigris and the Euphrates River, around the Nile River. And if you'll do an aerial map, an aerial search, now understand the world has changed a lot since early civilization. So there's a lot of civilizations who've understood things about irrigation and farming and so forth. And now we can drill for water. But when early civilizations were around, their only source of water was rivers. And so they were, the people communicated, they gathered around the rivers. It's no wonder that a place like Jericho was right near the Jordan River, because that's where life was. And if you notice, you do a Google search, a world search, and go over northern Africa, and you'll see that there's just nothing but brown except for a little green winding thing in Egypt called the Nile River. And right at the end of the Nile River, it's this delta area, and it's lush, and it's green, and it's growing. You see, you realize that there is what we see things in the realm of the natural. There is something as a counterpart in the realm of the spirit. There is a natural rivers, and the rivers and the river banks are always full and teeming with life and trees and vegetation, because that's where they get their nutrition, their sustenance from, is from the river. But we also have to realize that as there is life along a natural river, there is also a spiritual river that is available to the believer, that is available to people, that is something that brings life. And that means that we need to recognize that there is a river in the spirit that God wants us to tap into and be close. You remember Psalm chapter 1, where it says that blessed is the man who doesn't walk in the counsel of the ungodly, who sits in the path of the scornful or the sinner, but rather his delight is in the law of the Lord. He is like a what? A tree planted where? By the river, so that his leaf will not wither, and everything he does prospers. Well, it's imperative that you and I understand that we have the potential of living and receiving from this spiritual river, and just like the natural river was there. So Isaiah chapter 43 verse 19 says this: Behold, I will do a new thing. At verse 18, do not consider the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing, now it shall spring forth. And then he asks a question: Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers, rivers in the desert. So recognize that when we look at this verse of scripture, he said, listen, don't concern yourself with the way your life has been to this point. Don't look at what has been the old and what has been the past and what has been the former way, because I'm fixing to do something new. And so I believe that for you and I, we can look at that and recognize that there was a place and time in our life where we made Jesus the Lord of our life, and the old things are passed away, but the new thing began at that moment. that we became a new creature in Christ. And then he says, I'm going to do a new thing. And he said, shall you not know it? Now, when we think about it, he's asking a question. Don't you think that I am going to reveal that new thing to you? That you're going to know this thing, but it's not just a know something as I know a multiplication fact or an addition fact or a fact about an event or a fact about something. I'm going to have an experiential knowing of this new thing that God is going to do. That God is intending to do, God wanted to do in our life. We're going to have an experience of that in our life. Now notice what he says here. He's going to do two things. One, he said, I'm going to make a way in the wilderness. I'm going to put a roadway. I'm going to put a pathway. I'm going to put this roadway, this path down in this wilderness. When we think about wilderness, it's really talking about the word wilderness and desert are actually come from the same root word, just slightly different. The wilderness here is a desolate it's a desolate place. It's a place that's been demolished. It's a place that has gotten very little life. It's a place that is just desolation, and there's nothing that can grow there. Nothing can be there. And you know, sometimes we look at our life, and perhaps that's where we were. Sometimes our life was such that it just seemed like all life, all hope, all dreams, all anticipation has gone. And God said, I'm going to make a roadway to get there. I'm going to make a roadway for you. But that roadway, that word also means a journey and a destiny. I'm going to put a destiny in your desolation. Even when you're desolate, even when you don't feel like there's any hope, even when you don't feel like there's any promise, even when you don't feel like there is any potential, then he says, I am going to do a new thing. I'm going to give some destiny to your desolation so that you'll now begin to have some hope. And in order for that to come to pass, I'm going to bring rivers into your desert. Glory to God. And so sometimes, you know, we feel, I don't know about you, but there's some seasons in my life where things just feel dry. Things just feel like, man, what's the use? What's going on? I've been believing for this and believing for that and wanting this to take place and wanting that to take place, and it doesn't seem to be any life. I got good news for you today. God says, I'm going to do a new thing, and maybe that's where you are, but don't consider the old. Don't consider your present circumstance. Don't consider the present condition, but know that I'm going to put a river into your wilderness, into your desert, and I'm going to bring that river into you, and it will bring a supply to you that you need at this moment, at this place, wherever you are in your life. Now we think about it a little bit. You look at a topography, and you'll find out that rivers always start up in the mountain. They always start up high. They will start because of some snow melt off, or they will start someplace on a higher elevation, and it works its way down towards the sea. Works its way down to a lower elevation, either another body of water, and it'll drain in there, or it'll wind up out into the ocean somewhere. Do you know that the Mississippi River starts in Minnesota? And I believe if my information is correct, it starts in a lake by the name, I think it's Itasco. Is that right? Itasca. And it is 1,476 feet above sea level. That's mountain. Now, it may not look like mountain over there, but if it were close by here, it would look like a 146 story building. That's how high it is there. And it trails down through all of those states, and it meanders back and forth until it dumps off into the Mississippi Delta, which is sea level. Now, you see, that's why New Orleans had a difficult time during Katrina, because New Orleans is 14 feet below sea level. And they built all of the dams around it. Well, one of the dams broke and all the sea level water came into New Orleans and elevated the sea level at least 14 feet. And so what I see, you know, so if there is a natural corresponding to the spiritual, then we have to understand then that the river of God starts at a high point. And it's going to work its way down. I like Revelation. And it's chapter 22, verse 1. And he showed me a pure river of life, clear as crystal, proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb. So you got to realize, you got to know that the river of God, the river that he's talking about sending into your wilderness, comes directly from the throne of God Almighty, comes directly from him. And so it is part of that anointing that flows down. It is the river, and it is a pure river of water of life. And so we think of it, you know, water brings life, but this is a river of life that is going to flow directly from the throne of God. Ezekiel chapter 47 says, and he brought me back to the door of the temple, and there was flowing from under the threshold of the temple towards the east, for the front of the temple faced east, and the water was flowing from under the right side of the temple south of the altar. And then verse number 8 says, the water flowed towards the east region, goes down into the valley, and enters the sea, where when it reaches the sea, the waters are healed. Anytime you see in the Bible when it talks about a sea, or it talks about waters, but it's not naming a specific sea or a specific body of water, it can have a double reference. The first reference is this talking about the water, just exactly what it says. But the second reference is referring to the people that are there. Because, you know, have you ever seen, well, you ever look at a football game and you see especially one of the LSU ball games in Florida, and all of the people that are in the stands, and they do what? The wave. And the people just stand up at random, and it just looks like a wave. It looks like a sea of people. And so what the Ezekiel is seeing here is that the water is going to leave the temple, it's going to leave the throne room, and it's going to go out where the people are. It's going to go out, and it's going to touch the people, and it's going to reach the people. And when the people receive it, and when it reaches the people, it says the waters, the people are healed. Well, I don't know about you, but that excites me, because that means that there's going to be some healing that's going to take place in my life. Maybe it's going to be emotional healing. Maybe it's going to be physical healing. Maybe it'll be relationship healing. But there'll be some healing that's available as I tap in and I allow that water. See, that's the new thing that God wants to do, sending healing water into your wilderness. When you think about a wilderness, it just means that there is lack of life, there's lack of support, there's lack of supply, there is something that's not there, and so very often that lack that's not there is due to the fact that life hasn't been there. And so the Spirit of God wants to go into that place and bring life. There's a river that God wants us to have and wants it to flow into our life. Amen. Now watch verse number 9. It says, and it shall be that every living thing that moves, wherever the river goes, will live. wherever the river goes, will live. There will be a very great multitude of fish, because these waters go there. They will be healed, and everything will live wherever the river goes. And so we've got to recognize that there's God, from the throne of God, there is a river of life that's flowing out. And if all, in order for me to live the life that God intends for me to live, I'm going to have to partake of this river that's intended to be life for me. And so we might think of it, so there's a multitude of fish, but all the fish are healed. All the fish are there. So it's referring to the people that receive the Spirit of God and receive what's come from them. And we realize that sometimes at the initial reception of the Holy Spirit and our getting born again, where our spirit was healed, our spirit was recreated, if you would, and we became born again at that moment, at that time. But we recognize that the process only began that way. It began down in our heart and in our spirit, but then there's usually, for most of us, you know, we may have gotten born again a little bit, not necessarily real young, and yet there were some times when more healing has to take place. Sometimes it's in our minds, sometimes it's in our physical bodies, sometimes it's in our soulic realm that needs to be healed. So everywhere the river goes, there's healing. And so I'm telling you that this morning, that maybe your life has been there's been some desolation. Maybe there's been some real challenges. There's been some real difficulties. I'm telling you this morning, there is a river that's flowing from the throne of God, and it's flowing through the temple. Now, I like this, because you realize that the source of the water is the temple. The source of the water is the throne, but the channel is the temple. Now, you can look at that from two perspectives. One, you look at it as the church, as the temple, and the water is coming in here. But you can also look at you as being the temple of the Holy Spirit. And so the water is going to come in, is going to flow in from the throne. And we can either be in a place where we receive the healing, and we receive the touch, and we receive what the Lord has for us. And listen, we come to church with an expectation and an anticipation that God is going to take care of some of the issues in my life. And I'm going to put my priority first, and I'm not going to try to solve all my problems. I'm going to come into the church and worship the Lord, and I'm going to get into the river, so that as I get in, then the life-healing power, the life-giving power of the water from the throne are going to flow into me, and I can be healed. But then as I go out of the temple, guess what I take with me? I take with me that life. I take with me that water. I take with me that healing anointing. I take with me the things that God has placed in me, so that I can be that vessel, that walk that goes out through the doors and into the highways and into the byways and into the places that is intended for me to minister and to be in my neighborhood, to be the life of water, the water of life from the temple, from the throne through the temple out into the waters and into the sea. Psalm 65 verse 9 says, I like this, you visit the earth and water it, and you water it with the river of God. So I think about, you know, when God visited the earth, and there are several instances in the Old Testament where the Lord came down. It says the Lord came down. We believe that some of those were the pre-incarnate visitation of Jesus. Sometimes it was an angel. We're not going to go into all of that at this moment. But I do know one thing, that God visited earth in the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when he came, life showed up. Because the word says, in him was life, and there was no darkness. In him was light, and there was no darkness. In him was life, and there was no death. And so we know that when Jesus came, he said he visited the earth, and he was there for that 30-something years. And for 3 years, he ministered the life-giving spirit. And when he left, he returned in the form of the Spirit, or the Spirit of God, returned and now lives and dwells in the lives and in the bodies of everyone who would receive that and believe it. Amen? But so he watered it and he enriched it. When he watered it, he brought life. He brought freshness. He brought new hope into planet Earth where there was none there before. He brought it with him, and he says, and he enriched it. Now, when you think of something that's enriched, you think something has been added to it. You know, I'm liking to do a little baking, and so, you know, they tell you to buy all-purpose flour. And sometimes you buy all-purpose flour and you see on there, it's been enriched. Well, you got to look at the label to see what it's been enriched with. And if you can't pronounce the words, we're not sure whether it's been enriched or just some stuff been added to it. But I'm telling you this, that when Jesus came into your life, you were enriched. That's an ingredient that the whole world needs, that we can't do without. And so when we look at you, you could say, I have been enriched because Jesus, the Holy Spirit, lives on the inside of me. His Word lives on the inside of me. And so that's a good reason to be enriched. Amen? In Psalm 105, verse 41, King David is given an account of them walking through the desert region, walking through the trip from Egypt into the Promised Land. And it came to a point in time when they were desperate for water. And God told Moses to strike the rock. And the first time he told him, he struck the rock, and the word says that the waters gushed out. The waters gushed out, and it ran all into the dry places. Now, when we think about that just a little bit, I've broken some rocks, but I've never seen water come out of those rocks. So that is it's a miracle that God caused that to take place. But really, it was a prelude to Jesus. Because Paul tells us that he was the spiritual rock, and out of that spiritual rock gushed out waters of life. And it gushed out the spirit of life, so that anyone who would drink of that water. You remember when he was talking to the woman at the well? He said, the water that I'll give you, when you drink of that water, you'll never thirst again. Well, you won't thirst for the same thing. You won't thirst for being born again. But listen, I'll tell you this, that I'm just as thirsty today for the Spirit of God as I was 41 years ago when I got born again. Just as thirsty for the things of God, just as hungry for the things of God. And so although that thirst was quenched about being born again and making Jesus the Lord of my life and knowing that at heaven's my home, that thirst that was satisfied just led to more thirst. Because see, I want to know more. And just not satisfied with just my spirit being healed or my spirit getting that life. I now want to have that life all over me. I want my flesh to be as strong as it can be. I want my mind to be as clear as it can be. I want His power to function not just in my spirit, but all over me. and all over in us. And you see, that's the potential that we have as believers, that the river wasn't just for life, for you to get born again and say, well, you know, when I die, I'm going to heaven. Well, thank God for that. But on the other hand, he wants that life, that life from the throne, not just to take you to heaven, but to give you some heaven here on earth. To give you some life, to give you some energy, to give you some hope, to give you some reality of that's greater than yourself, giving you a purpose that's greater than just you. And it comes by his life, his river going into your wilderness. Amen. Hallelujah. Psalm 36 verse 8 says, they are abundantly satisfied with the fullness of your house. You give them to drink from your delight, from the river of your delight, for with you is the fountain of life. Now, that verse means that there's an offering. There's a calling. There's an invitation for you and I to continue to drink, to continue to receive from the river of life. There's a song that I used to run to. I'm not sure just exactly which album it is. I put some albums on my little iPad and my little iPod and clip it on my belt and put it in my ears and I'm running. And there's this one, I'm not sure where I got it. I think it came from Miss Linda, but I'm not positive. It says, jump, 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 jump in the river. And I'm running. I mean, it's just energizing type of song, you know. And Lynn Mink. Well, I don't know where it came from, but thank you. But it's just energizing. And so I just keep hearing that the body of Christ needs to jump in the river. Amen. We can't just take a sip of it, you know. And in Ezekiel chapter 47, early from chapter 1, we skip chapter verse 2 all the way to verse 7. But in that section, he says, so the Lord measured out, he said, the angel measured out 1,000 cubits, and he said the water was ankle deep, and he measured out another 1,000 cubits, and the water was knee deep, and he measured out another 1,000 cubits, and the water was waist deep, and he measured out another 1,000 cubits, and to the point where I could no longer walk, but I had to swim in that river. I'm telling you, folks, if we will understand that it's a progression, you may be dry, there may not be anything going on around your life, but if you just say, God, I want to get into this river. I want to get into this river of life. Then you begin to make the progress to the point where it's going to take you where he wants you to be. It'll give you a purpose in life that you just can't quite grasp on your own with your own noodle, but it'll put you in a place and it'll anoint you and it'll take care of all of those issues. It has to be priority for us. You remember Jesus said it this way, seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added. It's a matter of priority. And I'm telling you, as the church of the living God, our priority has to be the life and the river and the priority of the kingdom of God. Amen. And so as we do that, as we get involved with that, then there's going to be this abundant supply for our house. An abundant supply for our life. And it's going to come from his house. Amen. Psalm 46. There's a lot of places that talks about the river. Talks about David. I believe David understood the importance of river. Because in David's time, civilization was along the riverbanks. Civilization and life was all along the riverbanks. And it wasn't until Solomon came along as the king. He's given credit for developing aqueducts and developing channels and developing ways to get the water from the river inland. so that they could water their crops and water their farms so that if there wasn't any rain, they could draw it out of the river. But Psalm 46, David said this, says, there is a river whose streams whereof make glad the city of God. Whenever we look at the word river, there's three meanings to the word river. There's one, it is the natural course of a water stream. In other words, a river has a natural course, and it's the natural course of the river. It is not man-made. It's just the way the river has gone. That can be considered a river. But then there's the other two definitions. One has to do with not to tributaries. You know, a tributary enters into the river and flows into the river. But there are places where the river has been, I don't want to say manipulated, but there's been some man-made structures that allow some of the water to go off to another area. For example, in Morganza, there are some spillways. And the reason there are some spillways in Morganza is to channel some of the water from the Mississippi down the Atchafalaya, down into the Atchafalaya Basin. Because they knew that if there was a lot of snow melt off and a lot of rain up north, that New Orleans is going to float away. And so they have the Morganza spillway so that they can control the water going down the Mississippi. And so they send water down the Atchafalaya, and it's metered out. And so the second definition of river is those man-made features that draw from the river and bring it into civilization, bring it into the areas that it's most needed. And so these are not the tributaries that contribute to, but those that take from. And the third definition of river is the currents that flow inside the river and in a major body of water. Have you ever been driving over the Mississippi River, or you've been driving over the Whiskey River Bridge, and you can look down and you see those little torrents? Those little currents that are in there, they are currents, and those things can be deadly if you get caught in them. That's another definition of the word river. And so this word here says there is a river, but in that river are many streams. And those streams bring gladness, bring joy to the city of God. Now, often when we look at the city of God, it can be considered Jerusalem or Mount Zion, and sometimes we talk about it referring to that. But when we look at it from our perspective, the city is not so much the buildings and the land, but the people in the city. And so what we see here is that there's a river. And in that river are streams, streams that bring gladness to a city. Well, what would cause us to be glad? What would cause people to be glad? Well, if the person is sick, being healed would make you glad. If the person is in poverty, having an abundance, having all your bills paid, having a little extra would make you glad. If there's been some turmoil and some peace and some worry where you can't sleep, being able to cast that worry upon God, cast that care upon Him, and be able to sleep at night, guess what? That would bring you, that'd make you glad. Wake up in the morning and say, man, well, you know, you don't have to say who got the number of that truck, but rather you know that you slept well, you were at peace. Why? Because there's this stream, this healing stream that's part of the river. Guess where it starts from? The throne. It goes through the temple, and it goes out into the city, and it makes the city glad. Turn with you in your Bible to Isaiah 35. And we're going to close with this verse. Isaiah 35. Verse 1. We're going to read the first six verses and not expound on it a whole lot, but I want you to see, as I studied this, to see that this is the results when the river comes into a person's life. This is the results as they receive the river. And I'd like to, after we read this, the praise and worship team to come up, and we want to sing that "Let Faith Arise" again. Because we're going to give you an opportunity. Maybe some of this is where you are. And some of these things are what you need. And some of these things is available to you this morning. That you can have the results of the river in your own life. Notice what he says here. The wilderness and the wasteland shall be glad for them. And the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice, even with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given the excellence of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the excellence of our God. Verse 3 says, strengthen the weak hands. Maybe you've just, there's just been some weakness, not necessarily physical, maybe so, but maybe some spiritual weakness that just not knowing what to do, just needing some direction. You make firm the feeble knees. Boy, I tell you, you know, maybe your knees are feeble. Maybe there's some issues with your knees. Well, I tell you, physically, God wants to take care of that. But maybe there's some issues spiritually. When we're talking about knees, you're talking about joints. You're talking about connections. You're talking about the Spirit of God wanting you to connect you. And then say to those who are fearful hearted, be strong, do not fear. Behold, your God will come with vengeance, with recompense of the Lord. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer, the tongue of the deaf, the dumb shall sing. The waters shall burst forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. The parched ground shall become a pool and thirsty land springs of water. I believe that's what takes place when we get close to the river. I believe that's what takes place when God comes into our life and we recognize that that the river from the throne comes in and we receive what is available to us. Amen. And so it's a matter of us tapping in. I don't know about you, but there's some times when, you know, you go to the beach or you go to a swimming pool, and what do? You kind of put your toe in. You check to see if the water's cold. You check to see how cool it is. No, what we need to do is just go ahead and jump in. It might be cold to your toe, but once you're in it, you just feel real good, don't you? Amen. Father, we just thank you this morning.